It's a hot one today, but not as hot as this video is going to be. It's going to be incendiary. And as such, we go into it slowly. We go into it slowly here. We're not going to just rush into something that's so incendiary. Now, a little bit of background. I'm taping this in the morning here. Northern California, Bay Area. It's going to hit triple digits today. It's muggy. It's hazy. It's a wonderful, hot day. And we're going to bring the heat. I recall about a year ago. It was less than a year ago. Maybe last November, 2014. And I had this experience. I was desperate to reach some sort of conclusion in my path. And I was, I actually got into I was abiding in the, what we call the not seamless, boundless, non-dualness. And you can't really explain or define it, but I was aware of this. I said, wow, I made it. This is great. And then I was feeling questions as I was in this condition, the conditionless condition, and I was doing great. In my mind, I was feeling questions. People were coming to me and asking questions. And then there were these people who were all super enthusiastic, young, enthusiastic spirits, and they were kind of like sort of running past me. They said, hey, look up there, look up there. And they pointed to this all these like traces of light in the distance, in the future, in the distance. And they said, look, we're overcoming the darkness and we have this wonderful future. It's going to be so enlightened future. And there's all this enthusiasm. And I got distracted away from the conditionless condition. And instead, I found myself in a condition. And ever since then, I've been working to say, what went wrong? What happened? And I'm a workaholic, so it's like the labors of Hercules. And every day, I've been absolutely striving to discover what's the remedy for this. I got distracted out of no conditionness, so to speak, into conditionness based on a future, some sort of bright future. Now, we know that there have been enlightened ones in this world, and they insist that it's always right here, right now. This has nothing to do with time. Everything is as it is perfect, perfectly in harmony. There's no disharmony at all, actually. It's all right now. There's no need for any future attainment or anything like that. So intuitively, we know that it's not in the future. It's not in time. The condition-free condition. And yet we're distracted. We're distracted away from the condition-free condition because of some positive outcomes that we're expecting to reach in the future. And, you know, the attitude of this world now is like, oh my gosh, we got all this technology, we're so smart, we're going to fix the world, we're going to fix everything and make everything wonderful. This is this tremendous kind of optimism and enthusiasm by many in the world. And this is what distracts us away from. We think, oh my gosh, whatever I have now, it can't be possibly as good as what's going to be in the future. So, this morning, I checked in and I tried to see, am I distracted by this right now? And I said, no, not really. I said, wow, okay. So what have I done to free me from this distraction? What is it? And I'm able to, you know, have an answer for share an answer for, to everyone, to all, about this. And the last several videos have been getting to this. There's a practice I've been doing, which is zeroing out judgment, concepts, zeroing out judgment. And this is what actually works. I can feel that fundamentally, especially when I'm practicing zeroing out judgment, that I the skill of doing this practice nullifies the attraction to the future. It nullifies it. I can stay centered by doing this practice. Hallelujah. You see, this is the Holy Grail. And so as I imagine all these optimistic people saying, my gosh, we're going to fix everything. We're going to get rid of the darkness and troubles and sickness. And as I, that attitude, and as I did this practice of zeroing out judgment, I felt like it couldn't pull me. It couldn't pull me. It could not pull me out. It couldn't distract me. I nullified the distraction. So this is extremely good news for everyone. There is a way to do this. There is a way to do it. There is a simple practice that actually will work for us. Now, the only trouble is doing the practice. And that's the trouble, right? Okay, fine. So we're going slow here. This is very incendiary information. As I've said in videos, it's enough to not judge against truth. That's all we have to do. It's enough to not be to nullify distraction. That's the goal. As Jesus said, our goal is to remove the blocks to the awareness of the presence of love. That's enough. Remove the distraction. Nullify the distraction. We're already what we are. We don't have to reach what we are. We just simply have to nullify the distraction, as I say, towards a condition. We're already unconditioned. But as soon as we're attracted towards some condition, we lose awareness of our freedom and unconditioned nature. Now, the tricky part is that any condition, positive or negative, distracts us from our unconditionedness, the unconditionedness that we truly are, that which cannot be conditioned. What we are is absolutely free. It can never be conditioned in any way. So when we use these positive, what the ego does, the adversary we have, the mental adversary, arrogance, it's really arrogance, our own arrogance, is it distracts us out of this conditioned freeness by rah-rah-rah enthusiastic goal of some positive condition, like I'm going to be enlightened in the future, I'm going to be free, I'm going to be true, I'm going to be, it's a positive condition, conceptualized as a condition in the future, in time. And this is what distracts us, and this is what trips us up, actually. So in this practice, it's essential to use positives and zero out the positives. Positive conditions, the belief in I can attain a positive condition. This implies time, space, process, and form, format, structure, all of this striving. That is what distracts us away from what we truly are, which is condition free. The condition free condition, as it were. So in our practice, we use positives and zero them out by saying, I'm both this and not this. Now, why haven't we heard about this practice more? I'm sure that the wise ones have used this practice in the past, and they may have described it a little bit differently. Because we are so caught up in judgment, trying to be better than God, greater than God, judgment is the only tool we have for this. And we're so caught up in judgment that We feel without judgment, we'd be nothing. And so we feel that the way is positive judgment, right judgment, judging that, yes, I am the truth, I am the way, I am the life, I am this condition, a positive condition. And we feel that's we have to have that. And we feel that zeroing out judgment will be nothing. Well, we'll be condition free, which is what we really are. But we're very scared of that. So typically, the spiritual path first involves trying to go towards positive judgments of ourselves. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit. I'm exactly as God created me. These are all judgments, actually. The Course in Miracles is full of positive judgments, saying, you know, I am as God created me. I am love. I am the whole. I am very holy. Okay. Wonderful positive judgments. Now, what I see is that what I call the principle of accommodation is in play with the plan of salvation, is that we cannot go from believing in judgments, we have to judge rightly. We cannot just go directly from there to zeroing out judgment. It's too great of a leap for us. So what teachers do is they make accommodation, and what they do is they say, sure, okay, let's make all these really positive judgments, and let's narrow them down, and let's simplify them, and let's get really... And at the same time, they also interlace this teaching of positive judgments with no judgment. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, let them go. I need no judgment, you know. So they sprinkle the practice of no judgment, they kind of sprinkle it in like salt on the practice of making positive judgments. Now, I've always said, well, the Course in Miracles hasn't worked for me yet. Well, I can say it has gotten me to this practicing of zeroing out judgment, which is what actually does work. So it didn't directly, I can't say, you know, that the positive assertions worked. They didn't. Because positive assertions will never work, actually. And you can't say, I am the Holy Son of God, because that's a condition. It's a conceptual condition that we're so conditioned to believe in conditions and judgment that anything we say, no matter how positive, I am the Holy Son of God, this, we're really making a judgment about a condition, that we're this condition. And that distracts us away from what we really are. But what we feel we need when we get closer to the zeroing out judgment, we're very nervous about it. So we want to be able to be skillful in positive judgments just in case this zeroing out of judgment doesn't work. Okay, so we need to be skilled in positive judgments in order to get to this practice which actually does work, because we're afraid of, oh, you know, I'm saying, yes, I am absolutely the Holy Son of God and absolutely not the Holy Son of God. We can take every assertion that Jesus has given us in the Course in Miracles and put it in this new format of zeroing it out. We can absolutely do that. The light of truth is shining in me now. The light of truth is absolutely shining in me now, and the light of truth is absolutely not shining in me right now. You see, you zero out the condition, the judgment for a condition. Because in us, saying the light of truth is shining in me now, this is a condition. We're believing in a condition and judging, trying to have a right judgment. I'm judging for this condition. But to be truly what we are, which is no condition at all, absolutely conditioned free, absolute freedom. We will say the light of God is absolutely shining in me now, and the light of God is absolutely not shining in me right now. And this zeroes out the condition. If the condition has been zeroed out, there's nothing to judge. And ultimately, reality, there's no judgment at all in reality, because there's no condition to judge for or against at all. Reality is completely judgment-free. And it's completely condition-free. So, in saying this, like, I am the light of truth is absolutely shining in me now, and the light of truth is absolutely not shining in me right now. In order to say this and to zero out positive conditions, we have to feel like that we're very skilled in attaining some positive condition, just in case this doesn't work. Okay? So this is how I'm seeing it. I look at A Course in Miracles, the community, and I see a lack of success, an astonishing lack of success, and I'm saying, what in the world? This should have succeeded. Well, in itself, it doesn't succeed, because it's building up this focus on a positive condition. But if you read between the lines and really allow it to sink in, what Jesus is really saying is you have to drop all conditions. Free yourself from even the positive conditions. But you're not going to practice that way until you feel skilled in attaining some sort of positive condition, or thinking at least you can. All right? So this is why A Course in Miracles seems, I'm looking, where are all the enlightened beings? There should be thousands and thousands of enlightened, you know, beings, and there isn't. And the teachers that are teaching it are, you know, they're no great, you know, blazes, you know. I mean, I said, like, what? What is this? There's something odd. I said, there's something doesn't add up here. It's because A Course in Miracles is itself an intermediate step. It's an accommodation. Okay. Just like, well, it's an accommodation to get us to the point where we feel secure enough to take this next step, which is to zero out judgment. Zero out all conditions. I am absolutely the Holy Son of God, and I am absolutely not the Holy Son of God. Now, this seems to be completely counter to A Course in Miracles, doesn't it? Say, you can't say that. No, I am. I got to realize I am the Holy Son of God. But what we're trying to realize is a condition. The Holy Son of God is completely free of all conditions. It can never be a condition. It cannot even be the condition of I am a Holy Son of God, because that's a concept. That's a condition. It's undefinable. Cannot, what we are cannot be defined, even in the most positive of terms. Now, we might say, to use, for instance, a parallel, Ati Yoga or Radical Dzogchen in the Tibetan Buddhism tradition, there's this apex teaching which seems to just nullify all the teaching that went before. And we're at this point now in A Course in Miracles in our teaching, which is not Tibetan Buddhism, but there's a parallel to it, because we're now seemingly nullifying everything. We're not using even positive conditions. But this is the actual teaching which nullifies the distractions from what we really are, which is this condition-free condition, to use terminology, we'll say condition-free condition. And by practicing this way, I'm seeing that it very quickly works. And we're kind of scared of that too. You see, we want a sort of a long, drawn-out process, right? Says I gotta keep conditions and judgment. But this practicing, it's like, wow. I just right away feel like I'm not distracted by even any positive goals towards some positive condition. So we can even say, I am absolutely free, and I am absolutely not free. So when we say I'm absolutely free, this is a condition. This is a condition, and we're judging, this is a condition I want. See, the condition of freedom. We do not know what freedom really is. It is completely indefinable. It's not a condition at all. And our familiarity is so extreme. There's no way that we can just, drop conceptualization, imagination, pretension, arrogance, all this just directly. We need to practice setting it down. So whatever we say in terms like a positive is, I am the holy, I am very holy. We are imagining a condition of very holiness. And this is what prevents us from experiencing what we really are. So we have to zero it out. So I am very holy and I am not very holy. I am absolutely holy and I'm absolutely not holy. Yes, I already know that I am absolutely holy and absolutely not holy. Yes, I already know that I am the Holy Son of God and I am not the Holy Son of God. Yes, I already know that I'm already free and I'm already not free. So, it's extremely good news to find out that we do have this practice that works. And to know what this practice is. So, of course, it's going to take, some adjustment, whoa. But that's expected. Just stay with it. Stay with it. So, we're not trapped. We're not trapped. I had this dream last night. I went into this room. It was a store with a name, New something. I'm not going to say exactly what it is because there's actually a store named that. But it's like the New Practice store. Okay. It's the New Practice store. And I went in there to have something, to pick up something that's been repaired. I wanted to pick up something that's been repaired. So, and I looked in the store and everything, all the merchandise, everything was packed in these wooden crates, packing crates. There's no more merchandise. I said, whoa, what's going on? I said, what are you doing? You're going out of business or something? They said, no. We're moving upstairs. We're moving everything upstairs. I said, I didn't realize you had a second floor. I said, yeah, we have a second floor up there. Oh my gosh, I said, wow. I said, okay, where's my tool repair? And they said, it's right here, and we have some advice for you. And by the way, there's all these people sitting around, and they all had this silver, they were like coated in this silver paint or something, silver paint. I said, this is really interesting. What the heck's going on here? And then they said, look, we have some advice for you. The reason why you burned this tool out is you've got to be aware of the other side of the cut. You're only focused on one side of the cut. You have to be focused on the opposite side of the cut too, so it doesn't bind there. What's happening is it's binding there, and that's what's putting stress and burning out your tool. And I said, wow, thanks. I think I understand what you're talking about. Now, what was these people, the silverine hue paint, sort of paint to them? Well, I happen to have some idea about that. I've just been studying ancient history, and we know that Sardis, which is was a city in Turkey, super wealthy Turkey, 4th-5th century Crocus came from there, the legendary king, super wealthy. They discovered a way to separate silver from gold. In that area, there's a tremendous amount of electrum, which is this metal that combines silver and gold. And nobody could figure out how to separate the silver out. And finally, they figured out some sort of salt process, and they were able to get pure silver. So electrum separating out silver from the gold, silver being painted by silver, means these people were the elect, those ones who had been able to separate themselves out from duality, from the belief in conditions. And they were all packed up and ready to go to the higher up above. And they gave me this advice. He says, the reason why your practicing hasn't been working is because you're only focused on this one area of the positive assertions, and instead of both canceling out, you know, canceling out, yes, I am both the Holy Son of God and not the Holy Son of God. I am both absolutely free and not absolutely free. I am both spirit and not spirit. I am both abiding in truth and not abiding in truth. You have to do both of those to cancel out the belief in conditions and that you're judging for some condition. So this is what they were telling me. I was talking with the elect of God, actually. They were completely packed and ready to go. And so they're telling me, this is the practice. This is the practice you need to do so you don't get burned out. This is what will work to cut the holes. It was like a hole saw. And this is what will cut through concrete, cut holes through concrete with this so you can become holy. So I said, aha. So I started practicing this morning. And it's very profound because the goal is to search out your mind for every positive condition you can find. The more positive, the better. And then assert both that and the opposite, both. And this way you zero out the conceptuality of conditions, and therefore you're dropping judgment. So I am both abiding in the non-duality and not abiding in non-duality. This is the practice that ultimately works, and that we're not distracted out of the condition-free condition that we already are in. Or we are that, you know, I am that. But to practice, we say, I am both that and not that. So it's, instead of practicing to reach a goal, we practice in nullifying all goals. Okay? Instead of practicing right judgment, we're practicing no judgment. And instead of trying to reach a right condition, we're practicing not reaching any condition. Because what we really are is we're free. No conditions can touch us. No situations, circumstances, conditions. We are above all that. We cannot be touched by it. We're absolute freedom. So instead of practicing positive assertions, we practice this canceling out of positive assertions by both asserting and saying, I am this and I am not this. I am the truth and I am not the truth. Now, for those who are trying to build up, trying to reach a positive condition, this is like blasphemy. Which is why, for instance, in Radical Exoptions, they say, don't teach this to the those who are not ready for it, because they'll freak them out. But what I'm saying is absolutely practice. If you cannot practice this, then practice positive assertions. The most, like, say, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. But try to whittle down your positive assertions down to just one, if you can. Keep, simplify. By all means, do that. And don't be bothered. If you cannot, you know, too frightened to do this canceling out practice, then just work on narrowing down your positive assertions. At the same time, at least have one ear toward hearing the truth, this truth, say, huh, well, at least I have that potential. If I can't reach some great condition, I can always practice this way, and perhaps that will work. So at a minimum, try and do that. To maximize the help you get, start practicing this canceling out condition practice, zeroing out concepts, canceling out condition practice. Now, it's not easy to do this. You have to use the will, and there's resistance to come up with some sort of positive condition to practice on. This is what I've experienced. Because you say, oh, no, I can't cancel out that. That's a real good positive condition. I want that one. But the wanting, the desiring of some positive condition is itself hell, actually. Because any condition can be threatened and attacked. It's all just conceptual imagination. It's symbolic. So any symbols can be attacked by other symbols. Illusions can seem to be attacked by other illusions. So no matter what you get as a condition, it will never satisfy. You'll never feel secure. The heat is on. Wonderful. But not too hot, not too hot. So this practice brings the heat, but it's not too hot. I hear today it's going to be like about 100, 101, but not so bad. You know, if it gets like 113 or something, then you'd say it's really hot, but 100, yeah. Stay in the shade, take it easy. Not so bad. So this practice is not so bad, but it does bring the heat. And a big wow factor to it, a big wow factor. So we need to go over it again, that we're not stuck. There is a way. We can say, yes, I am the way and I am not the way. I am the truth and I am not the truth. I am the life and I am not the life. And for those who are focusing on positive conditions, they see this as blasphemous. They say, "Well, this is the deceiver. This is horrible. This is terrible, right?" So you have to be very advanced, and to be able to do this practice, no question about it. Because really, the deceiver is the one that is telling you to reach some sort of condition, some positive condition. That's the Antichrist, that's the deceiver. But we think that we have to reach some condition, so that the truth is just reaching some great condition as opposed to the ones that are not so great. But this is what's called duality. This is called deception. This is how we're led astray, actually. No matter how great that condition is, The goal of striving to attain a condition, to reach it, this is what the problem is, actually. Yes, I am the light of the world, and I am not the light of the world. I am absolutely the light of the world, and I am absolutely not the light of the world. I am absolutely truth, and I am absolutely not truth. Okay, so look for positive assertions or statements, and then practice in this way. Yes, I already know that I am both absolutely the truth and absolutely not the truth. Yes, I already am abiding in the fact that I am absolutely the truth and I'm absolutely not the truth. Yes, I'm already abiding in the fact that I am both absolutely the light of the world and absolutely not the light of the world. Yes, I already know that I am already abiding in the fact that I am both absolutely free and absolutely not free. I am abiding in the truth of this. I'm abiding in the fact of this. I'm abiding in the inherency of this. Yes, I already know that I am already abiding in the inherency that I am both the light of the world and not the light of the world. So we can put it in this way. Now another thing is that when we get to this practice that actually works, we have to be confident that we're not going to screw it up. Okay, this is another factor we have to realize. And all this practice, like for me in A Course in Miracles, and it's made me very confident in I can practice properly and do very good practice. So I'm not worried that I'm going to screw up this practice. I think this is a huge factor, actually. I'm looking at it. If you were to get to the Holy Grail, and here it is, you know, it's in your hands. You say, oh my God, you know, I don't know if I can drink from it properly, you know. It just might completely unnerve you. So, in some way you could say that the practice with all these positive assertions that Jesus has given us is to get us to practice so that we feel very adept at practicing. And of course, we won't practice unless it is towards some positive goal. We're hardly going to practice towards some negative goal, are we? So of course, Jesus says practice to this, you know. I think only the thoughts I think with God. My thoughts are very holy. You know, we can go on and on. This is something we feel like practicing, isn't it? So we practice, and we get very good at practicing. I've gotten very, very good at practicing. I know I sound like Trump saying I'm very, very good, but it's true. I am very, very good at practicing because I've done it. So here's this new practice that's been given to me. And instead of fumbling it away, I say, oh yeah, I can do that. Yeah, I know how to practice. Actually, yes, I'm already abiding. Yes, I already know I'm already abiding in the inherency that I am both the truth and not the truth. I already know that I'm already abiding in the inherency that I am both the Holy Son of God and not the Holy Son of God. So, I'm able to practice this. So it could very well be that there's no way that we can just hand somebody the truth and say, this is it, before they feel confident that they can actually practice it properly. Because imagine the stress of this. Oh my God, you know, here it is. I know the truth, but I'm just not able. I don't know how to practice. I can't do it. This is why I've been telling everyone, practice, practice, practice. In all these, every video, practice, 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 practice. So we've been doing hundreds and hundreds of videos of practice, practice, practice. Get really proficient at practicing so that when the practice that actually works is present and we realize this is it, we can say, oh, that's not a problem. It's like a song. Let's say if there's this actual song, if you played this song, you would be in heaven, so to speak. Well, what you need to do is start practicing a whole bunch of other songs first, so you become really, really good at playing and practicing the piano and playing. So then when someone says, okay, well, here's this song now that you need to play, and you say, no problem, I understand all the basics, is I can play it. Whereas if you didn't practice the piano at all, and then someone says, okay, here's the song you need to play, and you're going to say, well, I don't even know how to play the piano. And you say, oh my God, this is terrible. I could get into heaven, but I don't know how to play the piano. I don't know how to play a song. Oh, I feel so depressed. This is horrible. So I have been adamant in saying you have to practice. Don't think you can just conceptualize it. This is the mistake everybody makes. And I don't know. I don't have any feedback from anyone whether anyone's been practicing or not. But now we see why it's so important. And this is why I say a religious culture is essential. And this is now why I'm able to have an overview now of the whole situation and saying religion is essential, because religion is the practicing of positive assertions, really. It should be, and by and large it is. And it needs to be that, because first we have to get very good in our ability to assert and say yes and be with it and the wow of it and all of this. And only then will we come upon the Holy Grail and say, okay, no problem. I can do that too. I can do that. And we won't fumble it away. And when we fumble it away, if you fumble it away, you get distraught. You say, I had it, and I fumbled it away. This is what causes us to get distraught. And from my own experience, I know this is true. And of course, you cannot conceptualize this as a condition. Okay, this is the issue. You have to practice it. You cannot conceptualize this. It is 100% something that has to be practiced. You can't say, okay, I conceptually get that, I both conceptually get it and don't conceptually get it. I get it. No, you have to practice it, because we have to reassure ourselves that it's okay to be in the condition, free condition. You have to practice canceling out conditions. There isn't any other way. You cannot arrive at it, because then that's a condition. When you try to conceptualize it as a goal, you've just made another condition. So it's something that has to be practiced, not just thought about and conceptualized, because then you're just making conditions. Oh yeah, I arrived at the condition of being free of conditions. That's just making another condition. So what we say, yeah, I both arrived at the condition of no conditions, and I have not arrived at the condition of conditions. And say each very adamantly, so that you feel, wow, you know, I've canceled out these lofty concepts. So, it is essential that you do go through the early stages of making positive goals, positive assertions, and keep trying to make them higher and higher positive goals, and consolidate, and practice, 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 practice on those positive assertions. Yes, I already know that I'm already perfectly enlightened, for instance. Yes, I already know that I am already perfectly enlightened. Okay. Feels wonderful to say that, right? And then once you get adept at that, then you can say, yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in the inherency, that I am already perfectly enlightened and already not perfectly enlightened. You just add this twist to it, is what you do. So, in retrospect, I can look back in hindsight and say, oh, now I see what works. Now I understand the whole picture. So, the answer, you know, is the whole picture. In terms of the path, it's the whole picture. You have to walk before you can run. Let's put it that way. Crawl before you walk. Walk before you run. You get used to, hey, I can move. I can move around. And before, if you weren't used to moving around, you took a baby who was just lying there and couldn't move around so much, and then suddenly they went from that to running full speed, you know, they just shock them too much. They say, whoa, what is this? So you see children, they first they walk, they crawl, they walk, and then they kind of go a little fast and they slow down, they toddle along. Eventually, they love running, going real fast. Oh, I got somewhere fast. But it takes a process, a while, before they get the confidence in that to go really fast. So the mistake that I've been pointing out all along is, above all else, don't think you can just get it. You have to practice it. You can say, yes, I already know. I'm already abiding in the inherency of both getting it and not getting it. I'm already abiding in the inherency of both getting it and not getting it. I'm already abiding in the inherency of no condition and condition. I'm already abiding in the inherency of the non-dual and the dual. I'm already abiding in the inherency of being free and not being free. I'm already abiding in the inherency of being true and not being true. This can only be practiced. There's no goal to reach. So you just have to practice it. Yes, I'm already abiding in the inherency of no goal and not no goal. Cancel out the concept of no goal. But this cannot, canceling out intellectually is still trying to say, okay, I reached the goal. Cannot work. Can only be practiced. And then Jesus emphasized, you gotta practice, gotta practice, gotta practice, gotta go beyond words, gotta practice, gotta practice. He says, if you just take what I've said intellectually, it'll profit you nothing, actually. You have to practice, you have to feel beyond the words. You have to get the wow beyond the words. Experience the wow beyond the words. And ultimately, this practicing of canceling out all goals is, we can practice this because we have practiced trying to, you know, reach some positive goal, like non-duality. We've been saying, yes, I already know, I'm already abiding in the perfect non-dual condition. Yes, I already know, I'm already abiding in the perfect non-dual condition, free condition. Okay, but we're practicing, though, reaching a condition in our minds. We're still judging for a condition, even though it's super great condition, that our familiarity is with, entirely with conditions right now, you might say, 99.9%. So instead of trying to do that, ultimately, it's more profitable for us to cancel out the condition. So we say, yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in the inherent non-dual condition, free condition, and I'm also not inherently abiding in the condition, non-dual condition, free condition. Cancel it out. So it's not enough to emphasize the positive. You have to practice the positive. So, well, first, you might say there's these various stages. You first consider emphasizing the positive. First, the first stage is to say that you know, I want something better, and I believe it's possible. I want to try. The second stage is that you start actually emphasizing the positive. The third stage is you start practicing the positive. The fourth stage is you practice canceling out all concepts, all conditions. We call it fourth stage practice. So a culture that is not going in this direction is, first you need to be born, so to speak, into say, you know what, I feel I don't, there's something that I'm not really getting. I'm not getting what I really want. You can be born into this repentance, born again into a mood of repentance, where I say, I don't feel what I'm doing. The world, I'm not getting what I really want. You know, I'm lacking. It's just, this isn't it. Okay, that's the first stage. The second stage is then start emphasizing, I want something, you know, holy, divine, that I can't lose. And start emphasizing this, you know, divinity, positive, high goals. I want eternal life, in other words. I want eternal life. Third step is start actually practicing that, yes, I already have eternal life. Eternal life is what I am. You start practicing it. The positive, high positive goal. The fourth stage is you practice canceling out all goals, even the highest holy goal. So you say, yes. The third stage would say, yes, I already know that I am already perfectly divine. And the fourth stage would be, yes, I already know that I'm already inherently abiding in my perfect divinity and my not perfect divinity. Or, yes, I already know that the inherency that I'm already divine and I'm not already divine. I'm already abiding in the inherency that I'm already perfectly divine and already not perfectly divine. And so you then cancel out even the condition of I am perfectly divine. That's the fourth phase. And it's very simple, so you don't need to make it complex, really. There are those who will try to make it real complex so you can lose sight of the simplicity of it. You're losing sight of the forest because of the trees, because they're trying to emphasize some positive condition, like I'm divine, I'm perfectly divine. We do not have a condition of being perfectly divine. We are condition free. We attach labels to that and say, well, it's perfect, it's divine, but these are all conceptual labels, symbols, indicating some condition, and we are not any of that, actually. So, there absolutely needs to be, as I said, the religious culture is the only, you know, true culture there is. There has to be this momentum, okay? You cannot get stuck in someplace. And a lot of people say, well, I just am what I am. I'm human, you know, I'm good and bad. That's okay. Okay, this doesn't work. That's called pagan society or whatever. This is, you know, this is where the world is going, is collapsing into this. The same way, the flesh is what I really want. The dream of death is what I really want. So, you know, why even strive for anything else? Nah, this will make me happy. Okay, that doesn't work. The problem has been that making positive assertions, even that doesn't work. So we're kind of like, oh, you know, we've tried so much. We've tried religion. We've tried to, you know, to worship God and holiness, divinity. Yes, I want eternal life. Like we say, yes, I already know I am. I already am eternal life. We think, wow, that's super high practice, right? For those in the second stage, they're like going, oh my gosh, that's It's blasphemous. Are you? No, we're asking for eternal life. God, please, is there some way you can give me eternal life? I really want it. That's the second. That's the second stage. In the third stage, you're saying, "Hey, I already know that I already am eternal life. Yes, I already know that I already eternal. I accept the fact that I already am eternal life. Yes, I am eternal life. Yes, I already am eternal life." This is the third stage, but even that doesn't work, and so this mood comes in to society saying, "God, you know, this path really doesn't work." And then the gynocracy comes in and says, don't worry, we'll lead you back into pagan flesh happiness. You know, it's okay that it doesn't work. We'll lead you back to that. We know that the mother knows the way, the flesh, the mother, the flesh, just worship the world and nature and stuff and you'll be happy there. So we'll lead you back to that. This is what has happened. So I come along, I say, wait a minute. This is the Holy Spirit practice, do everything right, and it still doesn't work. I say, my gosh, I know there's something that does work, and we have to find this. This is the fourth stage, where we say, yes, I am both eternal life and not eternal life. I am both eternal life and not eternal life. I am both the isness of eternal life and not the isness of eternal life. There is both eternal life and not eternal life. I am both eternal life and not eternal life. Now this seems like blasphemy to the third stage, right? They say, what are you talking about? We're trying to reach this condition of eternal life. And, you know. So what we're lacking in the world is these four stagers to keep the momentum going, to keep the momentum going. Now the second stagers, they're not too worried about the fourth stage. They're just like, what the heck? It's beyond them. It's the third stagers that bristle, you know. Say, what do you mean? I'm trying to reach this goal. What are you talking condition? What are you talking about? You're trying to get rid of my momentum. You're trying to, you know. So it's like that. This is why, like in Tibetan Buddhism, there's this enmity between, you know, the gradualists and the radical Dzogchenists. Is they say, what are you trying to do? You're trying to bust my momentum up. You know, you're terrible. You're evil. Get out of here. I'll persecute you. We don't want you. So this is a dynamic that is very well known. Maybe not so well known, but some know it. And some of the third stagers will try to get real smart because they're still going on intellect and getting it conceptually. And they'll say, well, there's a fifth stage that's even above the fourth stage. And you know, the fourth stage, you don't really understand, you know, the fifth stage and stuff like that. They're just trying to outsmart themselves. They're still aiming for a condition. Well, yeah, there's this condition where you reach a higher condition than the fourth. No. You don't reach a condition. There is no higher stage, really. Okay? There isn't. But there's some in the third phase who want to reach some super condition. And so they just immediately insist that even beyond the fourth stage, there has to be this, you know, wonderful condition that we can reach, so to speak. As a condition. Now, we can have an environment, an experiencing that reflects our practicing of neither this nor that. A death-free realm, for instance. But we don't look upon this. The ones that are there do not look upon it as this is some condition that I've reached or anything like that. So, they understand it. The ones that are there understand it. The ones in the third phase don't really understand it. So what has to happen is that those in the third phase need to ease their way into the fourth phase. And the way to do this is to practice. What I've found out is those who just intellectualize spirituality, they're not able to shift into the fourth phase. They're saying, I don't need to practice. I have a very good concept of what I am. I have a very good idea of what my condition is. So they're not able to do it. Because again, I said that expertise in practicing is essential. When you get the Holy Grail in your hands, you have to say, okay, no problem, I can practice this too. It's like being able to tee off on the first tee. And if you know that you can tee off really well, you know your swing. Say, okay, I'll just do the same swing. So even if the golf course is like unbelievably beautiful and just, you know, freakishly beautiful, supernaturally beautiful, let's say, supernaturally beautiful, you say, well, you know, I'm not rattled. I can just hit the ball and move the ball through here, and I'm just going to enjoy it. But I'm not going to get all freaked out and panicky. So, in other words, if you're really, really good at practice, you get the Holy Grail of practice and you say, okay, I can do this too. But it can only be practiced, this. So if you're relying more on intellectually getting it, academically getting it, then you can't do the fourth phase. You won't be able to get to it because it's only practice. There's nothing to it other than that, because all we're doing is we're canceling out conditions. So we're not building up a path to some condition anymore. We're not trying to reach something, attain something, accomplish something, acquire something. We're just, whatever it is that we think we require, we're just then canceling that out, practicing. Like, realization, oh yes, I know that I'm already abiding in the inherency of realization and non-realization. That's all you can say about it. So there's nothing we can say about it. You reach a point where it's only practice. And if you haven't gotten used to practicing a lot, then you can't do this practice, because then you'll start thinking about it, conceptualizing, and that just nullifies, you know, the practice you've done. You'll set a goal that you think is attractive to. Attractive. Well, this is what will happen to us. And then you'll end up pursuing that goal. Say, okay, I see a real attractive goal. I'm distracted by it. And it stopped. You won't practice. So, yes, I already know. Yes, I already know that I'm already abiding, inherently abiding. Or I'm abiding in the inherency of supernatural, of supernatural realization and no supernatural realization. Yes, I already know that I'm already abiding in the inherency of superconsciousness and no superconsciousness. Now, I came into the world, I had the goal to reach this, and you can imagine I've run into a lot of trouble. What the trouble was, is I ran into the third phase people who said, yes, I'm working so hard, I've worked my whole life for super consciousness. You know, I'm practicing, I am the super consciousness. I dwell in the super consciousness. I'm asking for super consciousness. I'm Om Shanti, Om Shanti. I'm attaining super consciousness, you know. I said all those, I said, that's not it. It doesn't work. It's not. And of course, they were very, very upset and angry with me and rejected me entirely. Which is why I have no footing in the third phase practice of the world at all. I have no footing there at all. Which is why I just go to Catholic Church, which is first phase and a little second phase. Nobody pays me any attention. They don't even know, you know, who I am or anything, or what I know or nothing. It's not a problem. It doesn't bother them. But I can't attend any third phase situation at all. He goes immediately, you know, what are you talking about? Who are you? You know, where's your footing? I mean, what is this? It was like, you're evil. You're bad. You're ruining my momentum. And just, so it's like that. So again, I have no footing in the third phase at all. And people might say, well, where's your bona fides? You know, where's your resume? Where's your, you know, where are your degrees? Where are your, what have you done? And, nothing. Fourth phase. This fourth phase here. Well, what teachers have you gone to that, you know, that makes us, you know, that, I mean, what positive condition have you reached here? No, I know that I'm already abiding in the inherency of having reached this positive condition and having not reached this positive condition. Like, what? You know, this mumbo jumbo. What is this? Psychobabble, spiritual psychobabble. You know? Judge not, lest you be judged. So how do you, you know, how do you reach those in the third phase? Second phase, they're not, you know, they're not too interested in it. It's not, it's over their heads. Third phase, you know, they feel very threatened by it. The more one practices in the third phase, the less threatening it gets, because what you're doing is you're removing the fear that you'll fumble it away when you get the practice that actually works. You're removing that fear that you'll fumble it away. So this is why I advocate, I have advocated in many videos, practice positive assertions. Practice them. If you're not practicing, you're putting up an impossible barrier. You won't be able to get to the fourth phase. But of course, as you're practicing, you say, well, it's not working, I'm not, you know, it's difficult, why, you know, and it's not getting me what I really want, right? But it is rapidly moving one towards getting what you really want. So there is this tremendous progress, even though it's not the, you know, the goal and not the goal. You're not, yes, I already know I'm already abiding in having, in the goal and not the goal, in the peace and not the peace, in the unity and not the unity. I'm already abiding in the inherency of both the unity and not the unity, in the inherency of both the peace and not the peace, in the inherency of both the seamlessness and not the seamlessness. Now, is this a dualistic condition? I'm already abiding in the dualistic condition and not the dualistic condition. No, it's no condition at all. And not even that, because we think of that as a condition. So I'm already abiding in the condition-free condition and not the condition-free condition. So you can practice this way. Very still here. There's just a trace of a breeze, just the tiniest little hot, muggy, cloudy, another wonderfully wonderful day. Now, this is good news. So I present it as good news here. We're not, you know, just saying, well, it's too difficult. No. Because those of you who feel you're stuck, you might be saying, hey, go, wow, like, wow. However, practicing has to be done. Because again, the fourth phase is just practice. Now we think only practice, well, it's a lot. No, it goes very quick and easy. I already know that I'm already abiding in the inherency of paradise and non-paradise. I already know I'm abiding in the inherency of freedom from death and no freedom from death. So you're looking at me and saying, is he fumbling it away or not? And you can see, no, there's no fumbling here, you see. And you're saying, well, how did you get to no fumbling? By practicing positive assertions. And just practicing whatever I feel like practicing. Becoming adept at practicing. It doesn't really matter so much. Well, I would say that practicing, it doesn't ultimately matter that much what you're practicing. It's the effort of practicing that's more important. So I would just, every morning I'd say, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to practice today? And the Holy Spirit said, try this. And so I'd try it. And I said, well, that's great. I did really good at it. But where's the enlightenment, you know? And it wasn't there. I said, huh, but that was fun. I really enjoyed it. I feel I made a lot of progress. The next morning, I say, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to practice today? And then the Holy Spirit would give me another practice. And it was all sorts of different practices. And so this is really the way. Is every morning, spend some time, say, Holy Spirit, what do you want me to practice today? Not what, you know, what do I need to think today? What do you want me to practice today? And then to work on putting it into a format of practice for yourself. So you don't have to do my practices in positive things. This four-stage thing ultimately is pretty cut and dried. I mean, you can put your own uniqueness on it, but you do have to zero out conditions. So it's both this and that. Both and neither this and not this. Yes, I am that and I am not that. Okay, it's pretty cut and dry. But in the third phase, you just ask the Holy Spirit and put it into a format of practice. So I was writing, you know, like these all these sheets and practicing, just intensely, you know, I was loving it. It was great. I said, wow, this is amazing. I didn't even know I could do this. Every day, I would try to do some sort of practice, and some days I would forget and not do it, but I really made a great push, like the last 8-9 months. Maybe say, let's say 10 months. By the way, it's since I had that experience of that teacher, Longchenpa, this Buddhist radical Dzogchen master, coming to me in a dream, based on a cry for help, because I was saying, help, it's not working, what's going on? And what ever since then I've been practicing, because he's the great advocate, the great practitioner, knowing what really works and how to get there. So somehow he said, hey, you know, keep practicing. You've really got to accelerate your practicing. And so I got this boost from this venerable, legendary, absolute master of all practices and practicing. And somehow I started practicing, and every day I would practice. I say, Holy Spirit, but I didn't ask Longchenpa for a practice. I asked the Holy Spirit. I said, Holy Spirit, what would you suggest to be my practice today? And then the Holy Spirit would pop into my mind, like, hey, why don't you try this? And I said, oh, that sounds like fun. So I'll try it. And I tried it. The net result of this is confidence in practicing now. So when the Holy Spirit says, this is actually, you know, the ultimate practice right here, I say, well, okay, let's practice it. Sounds like fun. So I have a glass half full confidence about it. See, you have to develop this glass half full attitude through practicing every day, practice, and say, hey, I'm really good at this. I can really do this. Well, I'm very adept at this. I mean, for me, I say, wow, I really aced all these practices. You know, I have a glass half full attitude. I can do this. Yeah, this is going to work. I'm not going to fail at this. I'm not going to flounder at this. I know I can do this too. So this is the secret, is ask the Holy Spirit what to practice today. Whatever it is, put it into a format of practicing and figure out, how can I feel comfortable practicing this, and how can I keep doing it and like that. Now, Jesus says the same thing in A Course in Miracles. He says, practice on the hour. I never did that. I can't stand the idea of trying to think about, well, what is it, 2 o'clock now, or is it 3 o'clock? That drives me crazy. I just cannot do that. And he says, if you can't do it, don't try to force it. Now, some people live by the clock. I've never lived by the clock. I try not to pay any attention to time. But if I have to get somewhere, I always end up there right on time, because I overcompensate, because I really don't believe in time at all. So when someone says to be somewhere, I'm really afraid that they might find out that I don't even believe in time at all. So I end up arriving exactly on the dot and say, see, look how into time I really am. I was exactly on time. It's an overcompensation mechanism that I have. But so I didn't practice, you know, like Jesus said, try to do 5 minutes on the hour. But many people live by the clock. And so for them, this is wonderful for them. They say, oh, great, you mean I can use time, I can bring time into the situation too? Yeah, Jesus says, sure. When it, you know, 1 o'clock, you can do this. And it's just like, you know, in monasticism, the divine office of the vespers, you know, and I think that's the, it was at the evening, and mod and terse and sext and you know, the various hours of the divine office in monasteries and nunneries, etc., of those who are committed to that life, is they have this, you know, every 3 hours, every 2 hours, they go through and do the psalms and do the prayers and the affirmations. Basically, they're doing, you know, hey, I thank God, I pray for your mercy upon me, I pray for your holiness upon me, I pray for eternal life, that you, you know, in other words, they're doing, you know, first, second, third phase practices, which is very good. But they do them so, you know, they get used to a routine, which is fine. But for me, I'm much more sort of spontaneous and free-flowing. It's just like in when I was doing music, it was very hard for me to get to do a song. I said, no, I want to improvise. I want to be creative and improvise. So, but I didn't worry about that. I said, look, as long as I every day keep, I work at it every day constantly. So I don't feel like I necessarily have to have on the hour, you know, this kind of structure. I don't do well with structure. I feel fine with no structure. But by all means, if using an alarm or a little beep, little reminder on your smartphone, if that helps, absolutely do it. Use whatever device you can that helps. If you're someone who likes structure, then make structure work for you. Absolutely, of course. Because the goal is just become proficient in practicing, really. So your confidence grows and grows and grows, and so you have a half cup is half full for me. Today, it's very much half full. No question about it. And ultimately, you can get to this practice here, of the four-stage practice. Let's say, again, using golf as an example, I've had experience like this, going to some just like incredibly beautiful place. And you think, oh my gosh, I'm so distracted by the beauty. I won't know how to play. I'll be spraying the ball. I'll be like an idiot. But what you have to do is you just use keep it simple. And say, no. Just keep your head down. Keep your eye on the ball. Don't be looking where the ball's going. Keep your eye on the ball and swing through the ball. Swing through the ball. And just tempo. Just, you know, be aware of your tempo. Get a nice tempo. Head down, swing through the ball. And you'll hit it okay. Yeah, that's all you need to do is just hit it okay. The problem that happens is when you start looking up just a little bit too soon, that's when the wheels start coming off. Or you try hitting at the ball. You know, hit through it, extend through it, just focus on extending through it, keep your eye, keep back on it, your head, your everything, keep back on it, don't try to go forward too quickly, keep back on it, just a few little clues, and then you say, that's all I need to focus, the rest of the time, I'll just be enjoying the beauty here, and you just golf the ball around, and you know, works out fine. Hit some good shots, hit some not so good ones, but by and large, you just keep matriculating the ball down the fairway, and meanwhile, you're just soaking in this beauty. Oh my gosh, this is beautiful. I come up to the golf ball. I'm not worried about hitting it. I just stop. I said, let me just stop here and just take in this beauty. Wow. And just sit there for a couple minutes, just enjoying it. Especially if it's really hot, it's great. You don't want to really rush to the ball. Just let me just sit here and cool off, and okay. And then you say, okay, I need to hit a shot here. Let me see. Okay, now what do I need to do? Well, you know, just don't, you know, trust your line. Get the line. Get the right club line. Commit to it. Trust to it. And then don't pull up on it. Don't pull up on it. Just hit it and trust, you know, trust in it. There might be some other little tweaks you remind yourself. But, you know, keep it simple. You don't think too much about it. So in our practicing, we just keep it simple. Just keep it simple. Yes, I am both free and not free. I'm already absolutely abiding in the inherency of being both free and not free. In the inherency of being both true and not true. And the inherency of being both blissful and not blissful. Now, in practicing like this, I feel the distractions of reaching some positive goal in the future, they're not pulling at me. I don't feel the pull. Whereas before, I tested out and I'd feel a pull in me. And I say, doggone it, it's still there. But right now, in practicing like this, I don't feel the pull. Yes, I'm both enjoying the future and not enjoying the future. I'm both in the future and not in the future. I'm both in time and not in time. And of course, people say, well, it's just some in-between condition. Well, it's both an in-between condition and not an in-between condition. I'm both inherently abiding in the in-between condition and non-in-between condition. In other words, it's no condition at all. This is the whole purpose of it, is getting used to that, getting accustomed to it. So, the analogy with golf, the more you're practicing, playing, then you can go on better and better courses and you won't panic. So, the more we practice every day, the better ideas will come to us to practice. The practice will get better and better and better and better until we reach something like this. Wow, this is like the ultimate practice. Holy cow. And we'll just say, well, that's okay. I can just keep, practice. It's not a problem. So, again, the strategy that doesn't work is just waiting for some teacher to tell you, okay, this is the truth. Oh, great, I got it now. Concretely, I have this concrete image of what this is the condition I need to reach. This is what doesn't work. What does work is to listen to those who tell you to ask the Holy Spirit what your practice is for the day. How should I be practicing today? This is what does work. Because everybody's at a different place, so the Holy Spirit will suggest different practices, to different people. And you might say, "Well, I'm practicing this, and they're practicing that." Yeah, don't worry what other people are practicing. This is another problem. Now, in monasticism, the standardization of practice is a bit of a problem, the way I see it. Or you could see it that there is some standardization. They've been working on this for a long time. And then during the time when you're not doing that, you can be on practicing on your own, whatever the Holy Spirit suggests to you. This is also another way of looking at it. We don't need to iron that out. At least, I'd say whatever the answer is, I'm saying, okay, I see it. That's not a problem. Because monasticism originally was St. Anthony, you just live by yourself. Eventually, then they lived in community, but you were isolated, and each one was doing their own thing. And then eventually, they moved towards accommodating those who wanted to have group activities. So basically, there's three types of monasticism, and there's words for those, denoting those things. There's the hermit, then there's two types of being in community. In community, but isolated, sequestered. There's the sequestered in community, but sequestered, which is what a lot of the nuns did actually, because they wanted the protection of the community. They didn't want to do. Not many women did the hermit thing. That was usually men. Like Saint Francis was like a hermit. Saint Anthony's hermit was like, you're just a living on your own as a hermit in the wild somewhere. John the Baptist was a hermit. So you could be in community, but sequestered. Or in community and doing communal activity with others, participating. Those are the three basic types. So for me, it's like being sequestered is sort of I would say that's pretty good. That's just one as a style, and some want to be participating with others. Some people want to play pop music, some want to do jazz, freeform jazz. It's a different mindset. Just try to get a freeform jazz player to do some set, pop songs. And they just say, oh, I can't do this, man. It's just I've got to improvise. Come on. I can't just be a session player playing the exact notes you want me to play. So the best session players are actually jazz players, believe it or not, because they're the ones that get a basic song and decide, hey, wait a minute, let's throw this and let's try this and let's do this, and they come up with something very creative that ends up being the song. That's why music back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, when session players were, very much doing all the music, this is they're so good. The music's so good. And when you went back to bands doing their own music, and then now you just, the way it is now, whatever that is, the ideas and the musicality is way, way down, because those jazz geniuses. They play off each other, and what about this? What about this riff? This, and they'd come up, oh, they'd say, wow, look at this sound. What about, yeah, I like that. And they'd invent this stuff. They'd invent the song. And you hear it and say, holy cow, I've never heard that before. That's really, really how they do that. It's amazing. These are these geniuses. Improvisational geniuses. And then we think, oh, well, they must have had the music in front of them. No, they didn't. They may have had, like, a lot of the demo stuff is just some acoustic guitar, just someone singing the basic. This is the kind of how I want the song to go. And then the session players actually create the song. They don't get paid for that, though. They don't get royalties on the song. They should. They just get paid flat rate on the time they put into it. But they don't get royalties. But they're the ones who actually invent the song. I mean, anybody can come up with some lyrics. Are you kidding me? Anybody can compose lyrics. It's easy. It's the song that sells, not the lyrics. I mean, most of the time, listen to songs back then, I didn't even know what the lyrics were. I couldn't tell you what the lyrics were. I can't even understand what the singer's singing. Doesn't matter. It's the song. It's the musicality of the song that sells the song. Like a California Dreamin', You kind of get it, I mean, the gist of it, but walked into a church. I sat down to pray. Well, I got down on my knees and I began to pray. You know, the preacher liked the cold. He knows I'm gonna stay California dreaming on such a winter's day. I mean, that was a pretty evocative lyrics there. But when you're young, you don't really understand all the context of the lyrics, really. Not at all. I did not. So, some people, might like sequesteredness and just doing their own thing, and others want structure and the divine office to. Was how many offices are there? Like seven. Was there used to be nine or is it seven? It's been reduced to five now, I think. Vatican II reduced it. It's very intense. It's kind of scary. I mean, I said, I don't want to do that because every single day. And the Psalms, well, there's 150 Psalms. I mean. Yeah, you can get some stuff out of the Psalms, sure. That can be a useful aid, absolutely. But there's some limitations too. I mean, you got to go beyond the Psalms. Third phase, you go beyond the Psalms and say, "Hey, I know I'm already absolutely, totally, perfectly enlightened right this moment." All right. Adamantly, you're not begging for anything. You're not begging God. Third phase, you don't beg God for anything. You say, "I know I already, I never lost what God has given me. It's impossible. I never sinned. There's no guilt. I know I'm right now. I'm absolutely. I am the perfect Holy Son of God this very instant. And I always have been." So you make these assertions. That's the third phase, and then in the fourth phase, you say, "Yes, I absolutely know that I'm already abiding in the perfect inherency." Of being the absolute holy son of God and not and being not the absolute holy son of God. So the positivity is still there. You don't go into this freaked out, depressive state like, "Oh my God, I'm no, you keep the half glass full thing. You're full of enthusiasm and yes. Yes, I'm both yes and not yes. See? This is the ultimate yes. The ultimate yes is I'm both the ultimate yes and not the ultimate yes. You can call this getting out of your own way, which is those who are advanced in the third phase. This is what we're trying to do. This is what we're trying to do. Get out of our own way. How do we get out of our own way? And now we know. Now we know. And it's a matter of practicing. Not forcing, practicing in a positive yes. I am the ultimate yes, and I am not the ultimate yes. Yes, I am this perfect happiness, and I am not this perfect happiness. But you see, you don't get down like saying, oh my gosh, I've lost all my momentum. This is terrible. No, you say, I got even more momentum now. This is fabulous. And I both have momentum and don't have momentum. Yes, 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 I have this tremendous momentum and I don't have this tremendous momentum. And my glass is still half full, half full, half full. I'm not being crushed by this at all. This is what's important to recognize. So when you see somebody who is able to practice in this way and convey this, and they're not crushed, and then you say, wow, the ego's telling me that this is crazy, but I'm seeing it's not. You know, maybe I won't be crushed. And you start reconsidering, you know, maybe I can do this. You know, this is the whole thing. Maybe I can do this. None other than Ramana Maharshi a couple nights ago was in my dream and they're saying, yeah, this is what you need to do. Do it. He reassured me, yeah, this, you know, this is what you, this is it. Do it. Because he came back in about the year 2000 or whatever and then told me, don't give up. Keep doing it. Keep trying. You're going to get there. Just keep going. You got the right stuff. You're going to do it. And then he said just two nights ago, this is just very subtle off to the side. It was no big deal. He just said, yeah. I said, should I do this? He said, yeah, this is it. Do it. I said, okay, yeah, okay, I'll do it. Not a problem. Because I have confidence I'm not going to fumble it away. Right? So whatever positive thing you came up with in the third phase, you now use that as grist for the mill for the fourth phase. Yes, I absolutely know Jesus, and I absolutely don't know Jesus. Yes, I'm absolutely practicing properly, and I'm absolutely not practicing properly. Yes, I'm absolutely getting there, and I'm absolutely not getting there. You see, because what are we doing? We're canceling out concepts. We're canceling out conditions. The belief that we're getting somewhere is a belief in a condition. I'm in the condition of getting somewhere. Okay, so of course we're going to put a positive thing like, oh yeah, I'm really getting close to enlightenment. So yeah, absolutely, I'm really getting close to enlightenment. I'm really not getting close to enlightenment. I've really made all this progress, and I really haven't made all this progress. Glass is still half full. Still half full. I'm not depressed. I'm not freaked out. I'm not panicking. None of that, you see. Just steady, steady Eddie. And so, yeah, say, yes, I both understand what's being said here, and I don't understand what's being said here. But say that not as like some gloomy frustration struggle, but as a practice. Okay, so there's no struggle in the fourth phase in terms of your mind struggling. So you say, yes, I understand what's being said, and I don't understand what's being said. And say that it's a positive. It's just a complete, wonderful statement. I both get what's being said and don't get what's being said. Okay, and the difference, subtle difference is you're not saying, well, I'm getting what's being said and that's good. But I'm also not getting what's being said, and that's bad. You know, no, it's not like that. You don't have any negative reaction. You see, I'm both getting what's being said and not getting what's being said. And I feel like, hallelujah, I'm practicing properly. This is wonderful. Two thumbs up. Not one thumb up, one thumb down, but two thumbs up. this apocalypse, very interesting thing. So I both love this and don't love this. Absolutely, I both love this and I don't love this. But say that as a unified whole. You're not splitting it into two reactions. Like I'm getting the positive buzz, which say, yeah, I really love this. Okay, that's great. I'm making progress. And I really don't love this. Oh, yeah, I really don't like it. It's difficult. I don't like it. I'm not making progress. Don't split it. It's a unified statement. I both love this and don't love this. I'm both here and not here. I'm both here and not here. I am both here and not here. I am both free and not free. I am both here and not here. I am both one and not one. We're not saying we're in a condition of oneness. We're saying I'm both in the condition of oneness and not oneness. I am both in oneness and not in oneness. I am both one and not one. I am both one and not one. And then full stop in the wow. Don't form a concept or a condition in the full stop in this neutral zone. We're not trying to form some goal from our practicing. The practicing itself at this stage is the goal. It's the practicing itself that is the goal right now. So, yeah, I am both practicing and not practicing. I both get it and don't get it. I both love it and don't love it. Start off with a positive, because it's the ego is the, we trick ourselves through attraction to a positive, okay, condition. So, I am both succeeding at this and not succeeding at this. I am both a guru and not a guru. I am both a teacher and not a teacher. I am both enlightened and not enlightened. I am both speaking the truth and not speaking the truth. I am both doing right practice and not doing right practice. See, the goal is not a condition now, it's the practice itself. And everything is grist for the mill. All positives are grist for this mill. I'm both explaining and not explaining. Experiencing and not experiencing. I'm both being freed up and not being freed up. I'm both being liberated and not being liberated. I'm both reaching liberation and not reaching liberation. I am both attaining liberation and not attaining liberation. Now, here's the good news. If you're able to do this, I would say for sure, and of course, I don't want to say so much because that's not practicing. So we say, yeah, I'm for sure I'm going to make it, and for sure I'm not going to make it. It's turned into a practice. So the more you're able to practice this, whatever comes up positively, the more you're able to say it. You know, this is super great news for you, for sure. To step away from practice for a moment, you can be assured that, you know, you're doing fabulous, to say the least. That your experiencing it will be what you want it to be pretty soon. Let's put it that way. But then to go back to practicing, yeah, I mean, say, I know for sure my future, I'm doing fabulous, and I'm not doing fabulous. I know I'm really going to enjoy, and really not enjoy. I know I've really got it and really don't got it. So here we don't rest on our laurels, we just practice. We don't say, yeah, I've reached this practice, I know it's great. Yeah, I've both finally reached this practice and not finally reached this practice. Yeah, I've both finally found the teaching and have not finally found the teaching. But say both of these in a positive way. Not like one is great and the other's terrible. No, I both finally found the teaching and not finally found the teaching. Saying both is one positive statement. Hey, a little breeze. Nice. It's probably just that the hot air is rising so fast that it's causing a little bit of currents to come into the picture. What time is it? Got started earlier today. That's great. I've been doing a lot of graphics, and those are just fun. If you enjoy it, it's fine, you know? For me, it's enjoyable. I was looking at some of them and said, I kind of like this. This is cool. It's just very abstract and shifting landscapes, and the front is different than the back, and this is changing over here and there, and it's like, wow. Very, very abstract in certain ways that it could be helpful, sure. You can use the assertions in the Course in Miracles one of two ways. You can use the positive assertion of it, or if you feel like it, you can say both the positive and the opposite of it. Can say, yes, I have absolutely nothing to fear. I both have absolutely nothing to fear and don't have nothing to fear. I have nothing to fear, and I don't have nothing to fear. The Holy Son of God can both not die and not die. Yeah. Anyway, there's ways that you can use it to do this double assertion, this condition-canceling assertion. Can say yes, both eternal life is the only life there is, and eternal life is not the only life there is. Both. Okay, this is a strong one, right? And we say, oh, okay, right, I'm canceling out conceptual concepts and conditions, the belief in conditions. See, truth is not a condition of eternal life, nor is it a condition of non-eternal life, nor is it not a condition of eternal life, because that too is a condition. It's beyond concepts, explanations, definitions. We cannot define truth. What we are cannot never be defined in any way. It cannot even be defined by saying it's eternal life. So we say, yes, I'm both eternal life and not eternal life. Eternal life is both the only life there is and not the only life there is. So you pay your dues, like it's like the big leagues. The people who are called up from the minor leagues to fill, come up the big leagues to fill in. Someone gets injured, they call them up. Some it's too big for them. The stage is too big. They can't handle it. They freeze up. They grip the bat too tightly. They're thinking too much. Their whole their just mind's just like ah, and they just fail. They fail and they go back to AAA. When they go back to AAA, they relax and they do great. You get all these people at AAA who do really, really good. You bring them up, and some of them just absolutely fail. But there are a few that you bring up and it's not too big for them. Because they're the ones who've been practicing, 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 practicing down there, intelligently practicing. This is what I need to practice on. This is what I need to practice on. This is what I need to... And they've simplified it and they've slowed the game down. They've already slowed it down and simplified it in their mind. So when they get to the big leagues, they just keep doing that. They simplify it, they slow it down. They simplify it, they slow it down. And then they do great. They do great. Giants, San Francisco Giants have a couple of these guys that they brought up recently from double A, from the minor leagues. And they're like all-stars. They're just fabulous. And we're saying, how is that possible? It's amazing. Because they're very smart, very disciplined. They've already had this workmanlike attitude of simplifying and slowing it down and just staying within their discipline of work, work, work. And, you know, this is what it takes. This is what it takes to succeed at the big league level. You have to be able to slow the game down. And you can't have too many thoughts. You can't be thinking too much. It's reacting and seeing the big picture. You see the big picture and then you react to the big picture. And these are the ones that always seem to be in the right place at the right time, do the right thing. They're not overwhelmed. They seem to just, when a pitcher makes a mistake, they just hit it. And the other ones don't. You know, it's too much for them. Thinking too much. So when we're doing this four-stage practice, you can't be thinking. You're just practicing. You know, it's the big leagues. This is the big leagues. And when you're in the big leagues, you're just, you know, you're, when we're doing this, we're just practicing. That's all. Yes, I'm both succeeding and not succeeding. Yes, I both see it and don't see it. I both see it and don't see it. Yeah, I both really see it and really don't see it. I both really get it and really don't get it. I'm both really happy and really not happy. I'm both really optimistic and really not optimistic. I'm both really optimistic and really not optimistic. I'm both really hopeful and really not hopeful. I'm both really hopeful and really not hopeful. This is both really it and really not it. I can both really see this is it and really see that this isn't it. I really can't see this is it. I can really see this is it and I really can't see that this is it. If we do it that way. You see that the facility I have with practicing, I don't stumble, I don't panic, I don't get overwhelmed. I can try this way, then maybe not this way, then drop it. So if it doesn't work, that doesn't work, fine. So I'm not fumbling, you know. I'm calm, relaxed with it. Whereas if I didn't have the facility with practicing, I'd start freaking out, say, wait a minute. You know, I don't want to start getting into that mood because then it might get contagious. But you get my point. So yeah, I both really get it and don't really get it. I both really get it and really don't get it. You can try that. Yeah, I really get it and I really don't get it. And then feel like, hey, it's okay to say this. It's okay to say this, to practice this. Yeah, I really like what we're doing here and I really don't like what we're doing here. I really can accept this and I really can't accept this. Yeah, I both really can accept this and really can't accept this. But say that as a positive, glass is half full. Like, that's great. Yeah, I really can accept this and I really can't accept this. I'm really accepting of this and I'm really not accepting of this. Yeah, yes, I'm really not overwhelmed by this, and I really am overwhelmed by this. But do not say this as asserting two different positions, like, well, maybe it's this or maybe it's that. You're saying, no, it's both. It's both. It's neither and both. It's both and neither. I am both and neither really succeeding at this and not succeeding at this. Both and neither. Our purpose here is to cancel out all concepts, all conditions. Let go of all conditions. Thus, there's nothing to judge between. How are we doing on this video? I can't really see. What is that? Wow, it looks pretty good. If that's correct. Wow. That's wonderful. Yeah, I'm both and neither really calm and really not calm. I'm both and neither really poised and really not poised. I'm both and neither very self-collected and really not self-collected. I'm both really assured and not really assured. I'm both really assured and not really assured. Or we can say really not assured. I'm both really assured and really not assured. I'm both really assured and really not assured. This is maybe a little more potent way of putting it, right? And there are various ways of saying it where it increases or decreases the potency of it. And I've recognized this through practicing. And sometimes you want to say it in a less potent way, which is fine. And other times you say, let's shift it around a little bit and get a little more potent here, depending on the wow that you're feeling. So you have to, you know, go be aware of the wow and make adjustments accordingly. I'm both really succeeding and really not succeeding. I'm both really practicing the right and really not practicing right. I'm both really blessed and really not blessed. I both have a really blessed life and really don't have a blessed life. I both really have a blessed life and really don't have a blessed life. I both really have a blessed life and really don't have a blessed life. I both really have a wonderful life and really don't have a wonderful life. I both and neither really have a successful life and really don't have a successful life. I'm both really successful and really not successful. I'm both really successful and really not successful. I'm both really successful and really not successful. I'm both really blessed and really not blessed. I'm both and neither really blessed and really not blessed. So you can add in some track to word. You can just say, I'm really blessed and really not blessed. Or, I'm both really blessed and really not blessed. Or, I'm both and neither really blessed and really not blessed. Now, I was a last life to this one, previous to this one, I was a virtuoso piano player. And people would always ask me, how are you so good? You know, what's your secret? I said, the basics, the basics, the basics, the basics, the basics. You have to know what, you know, that you can add here or subtract here. Add and subtract. It's all about knowing the basics and adding and subtracting to set the mood. I was able to, you know, set moods on the piano. Music is about, you know, is about moods and emotions and evoking, right? It's the tone, it's how you play, it's all this. It's all about adding and subtracting. You're playing the piano, right? It's a play, it's a drama. And so I said, look, what you have to do is you have to be expert at the basics in practicing. You have to know them all. So you know what you can, where that you can add here and subtract here, or add and then go back to neutral and then subtract and then add, subtract. So it's all about this play of adding, subtracting, neutral, etc. And then you can make it very fancy and ornate and whatever, but you never lose sight. You're always centered in the simplicity, the overall simplicity of what you're doing, of where you're at. And so you never get stuck. This is what a virtuoso is, never stuck. You listen to these like jazz piano players, musicians or something, and they're just like, they're never stuck. It's like you listen and say, "Oh my God, they're going into a dead end here. I can just sense it. They're going to get into a lot of trouble." And this is what they like. They like to say, like, go off on like a tangent, and they make the audience think, like, "Uh-oh, he's going to embarrass himself here, or she, whatever," and they are going to embarrass themselves here. If you can say he's going to embarrass himself here, and you're waiting for the crash, right? But it never comes, and he does some like really funky escape from it, and he's like, "Oh my God, I thought for sure that, you know, and how did they do that? Why did they think about that? They escaped. Oh my gosh, that's unbelievable!" And that's what the people clap, say, "Wow, that was a very clever escape." You know, I mean, music. A lot of music is about playing on the. It's about the emotions of people and our hopes, and of course, we want to escape from suffering, right? So what the really talented musicians do is they're doing something, and they start going down a road, and it says, "Uh-oh, a road of suffering. They're going down a road of suffering here." And the audience says, "Oh my gosh, yeah, they're gonna bring suffering upon themselves here. Uh-oh." But they're hoping, I hope they don't. I hope they get out of this. So the great musicians entrain the emotions of the audience. So the audience are feeling like, "Oh, they're rooting for them. Oh, don't. I hope you don't crash and die. I hope you don't get sick and die. Oh, please, you know. But I'm worried. And of course, the musician, they know this. They're going down the road on purpose. I'm going to go down this road. This is a dangerous road. I'm going to go through that, you know, long, lonesome valley here, you know. Oh, my gosh. And the musician, like, if they know the song, they know how to get out of it. But if they're improvisational, they don't know. But they know, "I know I'm going to get out of this somehow. Let's see what happens." And then da 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 da, you know, and they'll just like suddenly they can just stop, you know, and then just completely shift into something else. And then something else is like really great. It's like, wait, what happened? I thought you were gonna die here, and you just like stop, and then you just shifted into something completely else. Oh my gosh, I mean, I can do that too. And the musician's saying, "Yeah, you can do that too." That's what it's all about. They didn't expect that, did they? They think, no, you have to have continuity. You got to somehow, you know, you've gotten into this dark key and you're flatted out and it's chaos and, oh my gosh, you know, you're just collapsing. And then you just stop, look around, smile, and da da, and it's something, you know, suddenly it's all light now and it's beautiful. Oh my gosh, it's just like sudden ascension. I just suddenly ascended. That takes a lot of guts to do it that way. Not many do it that way. Usually they try to find some way to work the way out of it. But you know, you can just stop. Also, you know, you might just say, "Hey, you know, are we stuck? And then do something really light and beautiful. And say, "No, we're not stuck. Look at this, man. We're still, you know, the flow's better than ever." Very, very few musicians are this confident. Like Paul McCartney is one that is. He'll just stop, shrug, "Hey, you know, what do you think? I mean, can we get out of this? I don't know." He hams it up a little bit too much, actually. He's a real ham, but he has the bona fides to do it. He keeps it light. You know, of course, they know the songs pretty much anyway. But the more intense, there's more intense musicians that will say, "Hey, we're going down this road, and we don't know what's going to happen here. Might crash and burn." And then like, "Oh, we are crashing and burning, you know, whoa, it's almost out of control, holy cow." And then suddenly, "Oh, somehow everything's beautiful now. We just shifted in dimensions or something. Oh my cow, holy cow, there's no crash. We're just cruising down this beautiful, everything's beautiful suddenly again. Wow, how did that happen? We don't care, you know, it just happened." So music can be a meditation, but it's a performance, and the problem with music is it's an adjunct to practicing, but you need to be skillful yourself in practicing. You can't just rely on some virtuoso to give you a good time, you know, because you're lost without it. Whereas if you have got the skills of right practicing, you're never alone. You're never walking alone, because you can practice wherever you are, as long as you know this full stop and the wow skill. Wherever you go, you can practice effectively, no matter where. And I've done it. I've gone to all these different places. I can practice there too. I can do this too. Yeah, wherever I am. Wow, I'm here. Wow. I'm both here and not here. Wow. I'm neither here nor not here. Nor am I not here or here. And I'm both a neither, not here and here and not here. You see how easy that is? It's just, it's like a riff right there. This is, you know, those are the basics. You can add and subtract from them. So this is like spiritual music. I'm like a spiritual virtuoso now, so to speak. Not quite at the level of virtuoso, I would say, but, you know, near virtuoso. Which is fine. Listening to near virtuoso is very helpful, because the real virtuosos, they'll really take you on a ride. And it's like, holy cow, you know, put on the seatbelt. Oh, the seatbelt's not doing any good, you know. Oh, my gosh. You have to be really, you know, mature to handle that, I guess I would say. So, yeah. I mean, this is the secret, and people would ask me, you know, they got so many queries. I says, oh, wow. You know, how are you able to cast these motions and moods and do play this way? It's just like a force of nature. It's unbelievable. Because I knew what I was doing, which was to take people on a journey. Okay. I wasn't worried about the song. I was focused on the journey. The meta message. So, whatever notes you hit, you're always still in control. Now, you can get really technical too if you want to, but really, whatever notes you hit, you're always in control. It doesn't matter. Like a really great singer can do the same things. Sometimes, on the rare occasion where the voice, everything is there, I can sing anything, it doesn't matter. I don't even worry about the notes. Doesn't make any difference. Or the timing or anything. Because I can just escape it and play it, and it just works. It all works. It's easy. There's no wrong there. There's no wrong to it. So that's why people are saying, oh, how did you come up with that? I mean, what were you thinking? You know, no, I wasn't thinking. I was just saying that I can do no wrong. Because I'm aware of the journey. Okay, I'm going down into this. We're going around the bend here, and this is the vista we're seeing. So I'm now evoking the vista. And, you know, I'm seeing it myself, and this is the motion that I want to evoke. So I'm just evoking it with the tempo and the intensity and the amount of notes and whether they're discordant or harmonious or whatever, right? And then you say, okay, now we're going around the turn here, and I want to shift, you know, what we're experiencing. So I'm going to evoke this now. So you're just evoking this. You're evoking it, and you're adding and subtracting. You know, adding, subtracting, add a little here, add a little this, add a lot, subtract a little. And then you can say, wow, let's just subtract all of this, boom, and you're right back to the basics. Suddenly, you know, you can do that. You can add a massive amount or subtract a massive amount, just like that, because you're completely folk, you're completely secure in the wow of it, you know, like that. This is the secret to virtuosity. And it's not all about speed and technical prowess. That's not what it's at all. That's third phase, so to speak. That's not real virtuosity. I don't even like listening to that kind of thing. And of course, real virtuosity is not just some negative collapsing thing. It's positive. It leaves you with a feeling of like transcendence, like, hey, we really can get out of this nightmare. I'm feeling like, yeah, there is a way to get out of the nightmare. So it's not just this experimental garbage. No. It should have an uplifting, redemptive quality to it. Real virtuosity is in the service of redemption, actually. And you can put in a lot of notes or leave out a lot of notes. Like, for instance, in music, like rock music or contemporary, like Eric Clapton, for instance, a lot of people say he's like the greatest, you know. There's other people say, no, he's not any virtuoso at all. You know, look at this other guy can shred. He's just like unbelievably, look at what he's doing. He's going up and down the neck, throwing all this stuff. Yeah, but Eric Clapton, it's more with the notes he doesn't play. Technically, he's outstanding, too. I mean, he can play anything, but he knows that you know that he can play anything. And so it's what he doesn't play. He has that sort of confidence that you know what I'm getting at, he's saying. You know what, I don't have to lay it all out for you. You know what I'm getting at. So I'm just going to, the tone is there. The tone is there. And this is the tone I'm setting. And you know where we're going, what we're getting at here. And so why do I have to shove it all in your face? So this is, you know, virtuosity, actually. He kind of underwhelms you. Yeah, underwhelms. But he's built up such a legacy that he can do that. You see, in the early days, he would try to overwhelm to a large extent with cream, overwhelm. But he said, hey, look, you want me to riff like this? I can riff like this. That's not a problem. Listen to this. And in these days, though, he says, hey, you know I can go there, but hey, we're farther along now. Just a little hint. Let me just give you a little hint. Very, very tasteful. And of course, everybody has their opinions about musicians, and we're not going to travel down that road much. I hesitate to even bring it up at all. But it's just an example. It's an example. Virtuoso can just come and sit down to like the piano, for instance, and just sit there for a while. Just look, be quiet for a while. They're in no hurry to play. You want a great, great virtuoso? You want to know who a real great, not just a great virtuoso, but a great, great virtuoso is? Ron Maharshi. He says, you know I can play. I can play anything. You know what I can do. I can say anything. So why don't we just sit here? What's the hurry? And he said, by silence, he was actually saying everything. That's what he said. He says, my silence isn't an absence of saying a thing. It's actually complete fullness of everything being said. Ramana was a great, great spiritual virtuoso. I mean, we're just still coming to understand how great he was, really. Yeah, it's just, wow. He indicated that previously he was one of the great Mahasiddhas of the South there. I don't know what they call him exactly. That he had previously been a great, great guru in the South of India. And so he indicated that in an interchange with somebody, said, yeah, that was me. So he didn't need to say anything because he could say everything. So that's the great, great virtuoso. The great, great virtuoso comes into the piano, sits down, doesn't play anything. And if you're ready for it, that's the ultimate concert. You come out of there and you're just like completely buzzed. Completely buzzed. That's what happened with Ram Maharshi. People would just be absolutely buzzed and say, oh my God. And they say, what did he say? What did he say? If you go home, what did he say? Nothing. He didn't say anything, but I mean, I just like my whole spirit just opened up, and it was just like I just went beyond words. It was just absolutely, it was the greatest experience of my life. This is just, I can't even explain how wonderful it was. And they said, well, what do you mean? What do you mean? What do you mean? What do you say? What do you say? What do you say? Imagine if you went to a concert of the great virtuoso, and you come back and you come home, you get in the kitchen, give me the ice cream, and just like, wow. And your family's like saying, what happened? Oh my gosh. It's a great concert, huh? Great. It's like, I can't even explain how great it was. Just really, wow. What do they play? What were the songs they play? What was the favorite one? What really, you know, flipped your lid? What flipped you out? What triggered? What was it? What did it for you? Imagine if you just said, they didn't play anything. Didn't play at all. People in the family say, what? What a waste of money. You ask for a refund. It's terrible. I went to a concert of George Jones in Oakland just before he gave up touring, really. And I said, this is my last chance. I've never heard him before. I gotta go. I never, really never go to concerts or anything. But I said, I gotta go see Jones. Greatest singer ever. And, he had laryngitis. Couldn't sing. He had to have his backup singer sing. And he just kind of stood there and tried, but he said, folks, I can't sing. It was the most unbelievable concert ever. This is fantastic. Half the crowd was standing up cheering him. This is great. The other half was booing and leaving. And I thought it was like fantastic. I said, Jones, you don't have to sing for me. Just stand up on stage and don't sing. You don't have to sing a note. We know what you can do. We absolutely know what you can do. You don't have to prove anything to us. Just be here, just to see you. That's enough. It's enough. So it was an amazing spiritual experience. It was amazing. Because we had people divided. The whole audience was divided between booing and cheering. People are yelling, hey, give me our money back. It's a bunch of really rowdy, angry people. And others saying, no, Jones, you're great. Thanks for coming here. You know, it's great to see you. We don't mind. And clapping and cheering. So there was this competition, you know, really. Because the audience, the negative audience was really like, you think, they're like getting really angry, demanding that we want our money back. This is a fraud. We're being ripped off. You know, they're aggressive, very aggressive. And the other side was saying, no, we're wonderful. We're happy. We're peaceful. We're calm. We're not bothered at all. And there was a super divide right there that took place. Most amazing concert ever, I would say. George Jones gave, that was his finest concert right there. I got to see it. It's awesome. He tried, but the voice kept cracking and cracking and cracking. Then he would go back and then try to drink some lemonade and honey, whatever he did, and try to get his voice. I'll get it. It's coming. And it wouldn't come. And finally said, folks, it's not there. I can't do it. And we said, that's okay, George. It's not a problem. We love you anyway. No worries. You know, really. People yell, hey, we're not bothered at all. Believe me. We love what you've done. You've done, you know, 50 years of fantastic music. And thank you. Not bothered in the slightest bit by this. Thanks for showing up. And the others were saying, you fraud. We're going to sue you. You know, they were saying, we're suing you. Give us our money back. We're being ripped off. They're so angry. So, this is incredible experience. This is the world, right? This is the world. A lot of people think Ram Maharshi, what is that? It's a ripoff. He's not saying anything. What a fraud, they say. What a fraud. You know, the negative, they're very negative. Other people say, wow, thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. Thank you for saying everything in such a potent way, you know. So it's very much divide, you know, there. They say, well, people say, well, what did he do? Why is he so great? What are you talking about? I said, what did he do? How many hospitals did he, how many dispensaries, how many hospitals, how many missions, how much charitable work? What did he do? What did he say? I said, well, he didn't do anything. He didn't say anything. He said everything and did everything. because he helped us cancel out all conditions, all conditions, all concepts, all conditions, set them down, right? And in doing, and so freeing us from the delusion that somehow anything can be done to us. Anything can be done to us. This is so. This is how it is in the world. May God bring us a great virtuoso. Great virtuoso. It doesn't say anything. You know, doesn't play anything. Just sits there. I mean, that's the ultimate. Because really, they just say, you know, I can play anything at all. I don't need to play anything for you. You already know it. And you too can hear anything at all. So just let that sink in. Just take it that I'm playing everything. I'm playing all songs. You know, if you start playing a particular song, you lose the greater context of all songs. That's why Ramana didn't say anything. He said, if I say something, you're going to lose the context of me saying everything. So if a pianist sits down and starts playing a song, then you lock in to this song. Where if it doesn't play anything, you say, wow, all songs. You might be able to hear just the awareness of all potentiality. I'm completely free of all conditions. Should we get into that or not? I don't know. That's enough for now. Let's not get too technical about anything. This is big. This is big. This video is big. Anything needs to be touched on, we can touch on another time. Let's just enjoy the wow of this. This is just wow. To see it this way. Why do we use the term Ramana Maharshi? Well, because he was, we know he was here. We have videos, we have pictures, we have many who went to see him. I mean, it's for sure. You cannot deny this. You can't say it's a myth. You can't, and it's contemporary. I mean, he was here until what, 1950? Well, it's not contemporary for most of us, but it's contemporary for our parents, our grandparents, and it's in our modern age. I mean, 1950 is, you know, is modern age. Space age was just starting to happen there and everything. So. Yeah, he was here. So we can really look at it. Can't deny it. Bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. So here he was, not saying anything. Even in this modern age, I don't need to say anything. I'm able to say everything. I'm able to experience everything. And everything. And on and on eternally. I am eternal life. So eternal life, the awareness of eternal life, animated a body here. Ramana Maharshi absolutely did. I am eternal life. I don't need to show you a life. I just sit here, still, quiet, say nothing, do nothing, because I am all life. I am eternal life. What is this? He said, what does this body mean? Nothing. What is this? What is an individual body to eternal life? really. Is it a condition for eternal life? No. He said, there's no condition at all for me. Cancer? Whatever. I don't have any condition. I have all conditions. I'm eternal life. And all conditions go on forever and ever and ever, so there's really no condition that I am. I am, and I am not. Just about finished here with this video. I never know what's going to stop, but we've done a really great run here, right? On this sultry summer day, August 16th, 2015. We hit a lot of great notes today. So occasionally, eternal life, the awareness of eternal life, shows up in this world with what we would call a body, but for them it's no condition at all, really. Both is and isn't a condition. They can say, sure, if you want to say it is, it both is, yes, and it isn't. Which one? Both and neither. So occasionally this happens. So, wow, we're really focusing in, we're really focused in on the whole totality of it here, and just get used to it, you get used to it, familiarity wins.